Hello, you are listening to the C Squared podcast, and today you've got me, Corey, and Curtis co-hosting, so we are quite a crowd. And today we are here with Billy from Doomed and Stoned, so thank you so much, Billy, for coming on.
Great to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Yeah, definitely. For those of you, I mean, most people are aware of Doomed and Stoned, but for those who may not be totally aware of you, what you do, and all of that jazz, do you want to give just like a brief nutshell intro of who you are and what you do?
Sure. Yeah. So Doomed and Stoned started in 2013, mainly just as a Facebook page to find friends who also liked this style of music I was discovering called doom metal and stoner rock. And I kind of put those two mediums together, which actually have a long history from the 70s on to present day. And I found them often playing together in scenes around the country and around the world. And so I just kind of coined the phrase doomed and stoned. And it's kind of turned into a statement all of its own, kind of an attitude statement, really. But it really just relates to those two styles of music that kind of grew up together and still thrive today. And so from the Facebook page, it quickly turned into, wow, there's a need here. There's a lot of the scene is growing. We got a few blogs, but we could use another. And so I started doing interviews and album reviews. And then I started putting on concerts, and then concerts turned into festivals, and then turned into a whole big thing. But it happened very organically with the help of some really great people from the scene who joined on as my team members.
So Billy, I have a different question to ask you, but before that, I want to ask, have you ever gotten kind of quote unquote in trouble for having the stone part of the Doomed and Stoned name?
I've learned, I don't listen to a lot of, that's not really the right way to say it. I don't have a lot of time to spend to find out what people think about Doomed and Stoned. And so it's only dawned on me recently that it could be mildly controversial and maybe even tantamount to a swear word for some circles on Earth.
Clutch their pearls.
Yeah,
right?
Mostly when I tell people about it, they just kind of smile and give me kind of a hell yeah. They don't even need to know what it's about. It's just Doomed and Stoned says something to them. And yeah. I think that's cool.
You know, it's kind of funny, just as a side note, we actually had a client years ago. You wanted to do a premiere with them, and one of them was a cop, and they were all like fucking paranoid.
Oh yeah. And somebody had told me recently too, you know, that because of funding in, some of the European countries being more public for like concerts and things that, yep, you know, it would be controversial and would shut down funding if their name was associated with mine for the purposes of that particular situation. And I think that sucks. I understand it, but I think it's stupid.
Yeah, no, fair enough. I have another question for you, but I should probably get onto the question Holly gave me, which is what actually led you to create Doomed and Stoned? Then you kind of went over it a little bit, but it's a little bit more in depth would be good.
Well, it's kind of, as many things are in my life, kind of an outgrowth of personal change. And in this case, you know, just new job, new community, new horizons, you know, changes in this, changes in that. And through it all, I became more deeply invested in music and really trying to find a sound that resonated with what I was going through in my life, you know, because those were both exciting and emotionally turbulent times. So there's times where you want to listen to something that's really exuberant and exalting, and that's celebratory of life, like stoner rock. And there's times where you just want to bum out and listen to doom metal and just solemnly recognize life sometimes sucks and there's not much you can do about it except kind of weather the storm. Not that doom metal is just about that, but that is how it kind of spoke to me. And then from there, it was really about meeting other people who were into the same kind of music. I'd visit all these metal forums online and it was such a niche thing. You know, people really either didn't take it seriously or, you know, there just wasn't enough people in one of these forums to warrant interest. People don't really expand their taste portfolio much beyond the age of what, 20, 22, 23, 25, something like that. There's some studies on this, but it was very hard to find people who were willing to like try to expand their horizons and get some new music in their playlist. But I finally did find my people through kind of my SOS signal on Facebook at the time. And it was mainly just for, you know, building a new community, honestly.
So, okay, I'll ask the next question. You've kind of answered this a little bit, because I was going to ask how Doomed and Stoned has sort of grown since its incarnation. But I guess I'd be quite interested to know more specifically how the community has grown with it, because you mentioned, you know, it sort of started out on Facebook to try and connect with other people. How has that sort of grown with the addition of festivals and all the online media and everything?
Yeah, well, I'm kind of probably not the best person to talk to about growing your social media community, because my experiences with social media have really come full circle to where I can really not stand to spend much time on social media. But a lot of that's because I've already kind of established who the people are in the scene, you know, who I need to go to for what. Fans are coming to us. We have the Doomed and Stoned show. We have other ways that fans can kind of meet us. So with that said, we have a pretty robust Facebook group. And I'm very happy about that and involved in that when I can be. But as far as where I see the community growing is really in real life events. So real life things that we can interact or exchange ideas or what am I trying to say? I'm trying to say festivals, concerts, you know, things that are eventful, and then just making more connections with local scenes. So when we put compilations together, I really try to get a team of locals together who can help me to authentically represent that scene rather than just kind of putting out an open call for tracks, you know. And that to me is really building community where it matters most, which is locally. So I'm really fascinated by local scenes, and I hope through Doomed and Stoned that I can help to support local scenes, because I think because of how big the market is, and also how hard it is to penetrate that market, because of the how plentiful heavy music is today. The key for me is to narrow down on scenes and to really showcase local things, local flavors, help people to just really get lost in the whole idea of, you know, Georgia or Portland or, you know, Sweden or whatever. And through that, get to know your bands. Otherwise, it's just a smattering of names and people just get overwhelmed by it, you know, because it quickly grew from just, I mean, the scene has grown so much and it was big when I joined it. And I could, you know, feasibly listen to every release in a year in 2013, and that's impossible today.
I can't see your face, Curtis, but I feel like you have a follow-up. Like my follow-up senses are tingling right now.
I do sort of have a follow-up. That was a very good sense. I just didn't want to interrupt you though. So Billy, this is kind of a follow-up. It's kind of like, but kind of like off the main tangent here. So how do you kind of, well, kind of not, but how do you kind of promote live shows, I guess is what I'm trying to say?
Well, mostly through local means, you know, yeah. Especially if it is a locally based type of thing. Like when we did our Doomed and Stoned Festival, we based it in Indianapolis, where one of my team members was, and she had just absolute gusto for building this festival, and it grew organically out of a compilation that we put together called Doomed and Stoned in Indianapolis. So even though I'm based in Portland, you know, it made sense for us to do our first Doomed and Stoned Festival there because it was going to be a multi-day lineup. It was going to attract a lot of people from around the area. So we try to think locally and regionally when it comes to those types of things. And then obviously it makes a lot of sense to, you know, spread your net widely on social media. I'm just really frustrated by how hard Facebook has made it over the years for for people like me to really reach our own audience. Yeah. Even when we pay, I mean, it's annoying for people sometimes to get ads, and, you know, why can't we just reach the people who are subscribed to us? You know, that would be an easy way, but we have to get clever, and you have to really grab the enthusiasm of multiple volunteers. And that's what I mean about community. It can't be just a top-down thing. I really try to delegate as much as I can to trustworthy people and really get everybody involved, because it's such an exciting thing when more people are involved. And then you start tapping into local personal networks, which are almost advertising immune when it comes to these types of things.
Fair enough. I do have another question, but it's a follow-up to the next one that Corey is going to ask.
Okay, yeah. So I'll get started on that before you trample over me, which, thank you. He's learned. He usually tramples over. Like, he'll either steal my questions or just like go off the rails. So the compilation albums are a big part of what you do. How do you decide who to include on these albums?
Well, it started as kind of like, here's the best music you're not listening to. And it started as kind of like a focus just on doom metal and stoner rock. And it largely is still our anchor there. We look for the bands in the area that are typically active or have at least made a big footprint in the local area, even if they're not active. You know, enough that you want to document their existence. We look for, you know, well-recorded tracks. They don't all have to be done at a studio, but we look for, you know, something that's going to be give us a fairly consistent sound. It's very hard on compilations to do that, but I, you know, we do try to have a certain standard to the sound. Every once in a while, we'll throw in something that is there for historical reasons, and it might sound a little off or whatever, but, you know, basically there's a story behind everything that we include. And that's really the value of taking the time to do it, with thought and purpose rather than just, having an open casting call. With that said, we usually do open it up and say, hey, you know, submit it. It doesn't guarantee you're going to be included though, because there has to be some level of authenticity to it. You know, these need to be bands that actually exist, you know, that play in these areas, or at least just have accomplished something noteworthy that's worthy of attention. So, so the compilations started about a year after Doom and Stone began in 2014. And they have continued to this day, but they are becoming a little bit more niche, because it's fairly easy to put, you know, a compilation together that's maybe country specific or, you know, even state specific to a certain degree. But more and more, I'm interested in what kind of stories can we tell through these compilations. You know, one of our compilations included liner notes, and I want to start doing something like that as well. And in addition, we've had increasing demand for a physical release of the compilations, which would be very hard to do past tense, but moving forward, I think that's something that makes a lot of sense. And so there may be exciting news coming out of that front soon.
So my follow-up question, the compilation. So most of them are pretty long, to put it mildly. Mm-hmm. How do you kind of, well, first of all, why do you make them so long? I guess is the first part of the question. Like,
yeah,
why that long?
I guess part of it is because of the abundance of the sound there, and to really just, you know, if we're going to do Doom and Stone in Portland, I want to give you a real authentic picture of just how much heavy music there is in Portland and how good it all is. But I recognize that probably has more appeal to the genre purist, you know, someone who really wants to know every doom metal band and every stoner rock band. So moving forward, especially if we consider physical releases, it's going to be impossible to make them that voluminous, that sprawling. And so, with that said, you'll probably see much smaller, more curated, albums based upon sound compatibility and contrast and that kind of thing. And that will probably represent kind of a turning point for the compilations, because they'll probably be, you know, all like that moving forward. We'll see. We'll see. Don't quote me on that. Well, I guess I'm quoting myself on that by putting it on the record. But yeah, I'm just kind of thinking out loud about it. The Doomed in Stone in Russia was probably one of our longest. It had 100 tracks. Yeah. But that was a countrywide survey, and it was the first of its kind. So at least in the Doom Stoner community, and it may have been the first that I'm aware of that was that comprehensive. And we did two volumes of it too. So it gets a little ridiculous. It kind of lampoons itself, I guess, at a certain point. But to me, it's also documenting something really precious, which is real activity from real human beings that are doing something that matters. And you know, if we were to do Doomed in Stone in America, in the Americas, or even Canada and the United States, it would be ridiculous just to include 100 tracks. You would think that there should be 500, you know. So a lot of it should be contextualized by what we're covering, but I think we could probably do a better job of that, honestly, is putting more story around it. We try to do that in our introductions and things, but most of all, I think we just want people to have fun with it and just enjoy the discoveries and then put together their own playlists and compilations, because they're all free to download and you can just mix and match and create your own playlist. It's amazing how much good music is out there, and it just grinds me to tears when people listen to the golden oldies over and over and over and over again and don't realize how much fresh material there is out there to revel in.
So I got one more follow-up on this question before Holly asks her, which is, so how do you kind of find the band? Do they submit, or do you go on a big massive hunt?
That's where I organize the local team. So I usually start with my own personal network and either ask for recommendations or, you know, work with people I already know who are in that local area and involved in the music scene in a significant way, so that they have some rapport with the bands. And then from there, it starts to work a little bit more, to where they might do a hunt, or they might do and more of an open casting call, depending that, you know, on how they work their individual social strategies. But we usually end up getting a pretty good representation of the scene. Like Doomed in Stone in Scotland was that way, and it just worked out so marvelously. And we always like to, whenever possible, source the album art locally too, so you get a flavor of that as well. And it's just such a beautiful project when these come together, not just because you have bands from that area, but because of the process it took to bring that project together, and just how much support there is and pride community-wise when these compilations come out because of all that buildup.
Fair enough. You know what? I just realized I got the next question, not Holly. So it's me again.
Okay.
So you also have the Doomed in Stone show. So how did that begin?
That began initially as a chance for me to get back on the radio. That was my first job, was a disc jockey. And it had been years and years since I'd been on the radio. And there was a radio station online called Grip of Delusion Radio, and asked if I wanted to do a show there. And I said, absolutely. And I didn't know what I was going to do, but it started with the Doom Charts countdown, because the Doom Charts started in 2014. And my first ever broadcast of the Doomed in Stone show was a Doom Charts countdown show, where I just kind of picked my favorite tracks from the top 20 or whatever, and then we played that and I would talk a little bit about them. And that kind of went on for many years, until about 3 years ago, that I hooked up with a promoter out of Las Vegas named John Guest, Vegas Rock Revolution. And he and I made kind of a nice odd couple, very lively personalities, but very contrasting at the same time. And it just made for a good banter to pair with the tracks. And so basically we just have an in-depth discussion about the tracks with, you know, side trails, and then play some music and do that again for about four segments. And that's the show.
Fair enough. You know what? I just realized we never asked you about the Doom Charts, and we probably should, because that's probably a key thing. Do you want to kind of go over how you guys kind of figure out who is on the Doom charts?
Yeah, so the idea behind the Doom charts was to bring together all the bloggers. Initially, it was just all the bloggers, people who are actually reviewing music. Then it was expanded to include DJs and podcasters and others who were also, in some sense, you know, reviewing or critiquing or curating the musical experience for their listeners or readership. And primarily those in the heavy underground, which is kind of a big umbrella that we put over the scene that includes not only doom metal and stoner rock, but progressive and psychedelic iterations of metal and heavy music, some post-metal sometimes gets in. It really just depends on what we submit each month, because that's always the big question is, what is this going to look like? Because none of us know. There's, you know, a certain number of, I don't know what the membership of the Doom Charts is right now. As far as contributors, I think it's somewhere lingering around 20, 30 active members. And I think we have a roster that may be as high as 50, but I could be misremembering. And each month, the call is open, you know, submit your list, and we each submit our individual 25. And then the point person for that month goes through and tallies all the ones that are similar, gives them a certain ranking for where we ranked them. They get certain points for that. And through this system, basically, it all gets put together in this nice little top 30 list. And that becomes the Doom charts for the month. So even though I might have a very Doom heavy list myself, if other members of the charts were more impressed by something I'm not listening to, my pick may not end up at number one. Even if I put it at number one, it could end up number 30, or it may not make the charts at all, depending. It's always kind of a wild card what we're going to get each month, but that's kind of the fun of it for us. Yeah. is we're introducing each other to new music as much as we are the people who are following it. Mostly that's how it works. And then we have, you know, giveaways and things like that too.
Fair enough. Now what else do I want to ask about the Doom Church? So just to sum it up, so basically everybody submits, it's 30 per month. Is that right? Or did I misunderstand it?
Yeah, I mean, it's really supposed to be a top 25, but
okay.
In the past year, it became aware we're not giving enough love to some of these bands that are actually showing up a lot on our lists. Let's expand it to 30. And then there's a second edition that comes out that goes into some that didn't make the charts but that are still noteworthy. And that's more opinion based, but this one is more curated list of opinion based picks, and it's all kind of tallied mathematically based upon the value given to each placement on our individual charts.
I can't believe you guys can get like 50 people to do a pick of 25 every freaking month. That's insane to me. But
yeah, I mean, it's not always 50 people. I mean,
sure.
Actual participation will hover around, you know, 20 to 30. But yeah, if we did have everybody there, it would definitely make. I think the pressure is on. Honestly, we haven't even talked about this, but I feel like the pressure is on to make the Doom charts. Just kind of subdivide them into different subcategories, because we're just, and the pressure isn't coming from any person. It's coming from the scene itself, producing so much good product. You know, there's more and more bands that are just doing more and more interesting things. And it's kind of, evolving into, you know, all kinds of combinations, that are just fascinating to watch, you know, Black and Doom and psychedelic stoner metal. And, you know, you have all these combinations, progressive. I mean, there's bands that we've progressive, post-metal, black metal, death metal, and doom metal into their, you know, so I hope we keep it like it is, because it's good and manageable. And yeah, you're going to miss a lot, but that's kind of why you want to go to the individual blogs that are listed at the bottom from the contributors, is to kind of see, okay, well, if I really do like the more stoner psychedelic stuff, where can I go for that? And
yeah,
that makes more sense to me.
Fair enough. I think that's all I got. Do either one of you two have more questions? Because we're on the final one. No.
I promise I am an interesting guy.
No, you've been great, Billy. You've been great. We just ran out of questions.
I'm just kidding.
Is there anything else that actually you want to bring up that we haven't brought up?
You know, there's always cool stuff going on. My mind is always like bubbling with new possibilities, and I'll probably have a lot more to tell you next time we're on, because I've got some ideas. I don't know if I'm quite ready to put them out into the world yet, but we'll see how they develop as time goes along.
I've got one.
Okay.
Since you are from my area, what, in your opinion, is the Portland band that everybody should listen to, that everybody should go check out?
Ooh.
Well, I'd probably say that'd be Witch Mountain, without question. Witch Mountain, yeah. I think that they're probably a good definitive picture of Portland in many ways. You know, it's kind of jazzy, but it's also dark and bluesy. And they kind of really incorporate those elements in there. But Red Fang is a good party band. I think everybody that listens to them gets into them. So maybe they should be the definitive band to introduce. I don't know. It depends on what side of Portland you're wanting to look at. You know, Blackwater Holy Light is my latest favorite from the area.
Can't go wrong with Blackwater Holy Light. I did a review of their last album and it was fantastic.
Yeah. I want to do a discography overview, because every time I try to write a review, I just, like, words fail me because I just love their music so much. So a lot of good bands.
So what about non-Doom Portland definitive band, just out of curiosity, Billy?
Oh, you're challenging me now.
I am. I'm sorry. That's my follow-up question.
Oh, shit. I was not ready for that.
Boom. I'm always ready to put you on the spot.
Yeah. I'm just trying to think of some of the bills that I've seen. And there's probably a lot of death metal that I'm not aware of. But yeah. No, I mean, for me, like, I don't actually live in Portland. I live in Eugene. So... Yes. You know, the definitive band down here is Yob, for sure.
Oh yeah, for sure. I didn't realize you were in Eugene. That's where I was born. Sacred Heart. Kidding.
No way. Awesome. I got a shoulder fixed that was dislodged at Sacred Heart a couple years ago.
Oh, so you went to the new one. I was born at the old one.
Oh, I went to the old one.
Redid it.
Yeah, I've been to both, but I went to the old one on campus.
Oregon for life. Okay. Here is the definitive Oregon question. And I already think I know your answer. Ducks or beavers?
You know, I've leaned ducks my whole life, but lately I'm starting to see the allure of the beavers. And it's, yeah, I know it's sacrilegious to say, and yes. Eugene, but
I'm sure the mob is already forming outside of your house.
Yeah, I don't think most people care, but I mean, they used to care pretty passionately, but the Ducks kind of got a big boost from Nike with support, and a lot of people resented them for it, and it became sort of like the Hollywood Ducks, and so I can understand the appeal of the Beavers for that reason, because, you know, they're both state universities, but Oregon State is definitely, you know, more your cut and dried Oregonian type of university.
For those that don't know, the Ducks and the Beavers are the two main college sports teams. So
I gathered that after a minute, because I was like, why are you guys talking about Ducks and Beavers?
Yes. And I went to OSU, which is the Beaver School, and he lives in Eugene, where University of Oregon is, which is the Duck School.
Okay. I thought we were just talking about the animals. Yes, I got an arts
degree from the sciences school. Makes no sense, but whatever.
Whatever. Does anybody else have any more questions for Billy, Corey, Holly?
No, I'm good. I asked my silly ones.
Cool. Holly, you got any more?
Okay, if you could be a road sign, what road sign would you be?
Never been asked that question before.
That's amazing. I love you.
Oh, man. If I could be a road sign, like... what I really want to do is not be a stop sign. You know, I want to be that green go. I don't even want to be like the yellow yield or be cautious. I just want to be that go. You know, I really need that in my life right now. It's just a big boost of go. And I feel like it's coming, you know, with spring, more sunshine, more activity, you know, kind of getting out of winter. My creativity is starting to bubble again. So yeah, I don't know if there's a go sign other than the stoplight though.
Fair.
Go. Fair. There should be, huh?
Just there should go. Be a green light or a green go sign.
Yes.
So I think I've got all my questions. Holly, I guess it's time to wrap up.
Yes. Yeah, so, well, thank you for coming on, Billy. Do you want to plug any links, anywhere people can find you, anything like that?
Oh, sure. Thank you for offering that. So home base is doomedandstoned.com. And then you can hear our podcast across the internet on multiple podcasting platforms, including SoundCloud and MixCloud and Spotify and Apple and all the rest. And then lastly, like if you guys are interested, we just got t-shirts and they're pretty cool. And we got our first hoodie shipping worldwide, which is awesome. We're working with Witchcraft's merch person. And so we're shipping worldwide and that's at doomedandstoned.bandcamp.com/merch. And you can also find our compilations on there and they're all free.
Awesome. All right. Well, we're going to go and get tea and crumpets. So thanks for listening.
Nice.
See you next time.
All right. Thank you.